I mean, it was the whole fact that Oscar Pistorius made the Olympics is truly an amazing story. He's an awesome athlete, and then to make it to the semifinals and finish second in his quarterfinal heat is just impressive. It was really great to see how the other athletes reacted to him. Oscar's actually disadvantaged using his prosthetic limbs, or his blades, as the announcers call them, or the other athletes call them, because they're purely passive. The simplest way to think of it is he's running on two springs, and they can only store energy that he puts into them. They can't deliver energy to the ground like the lower leg and the foot of a running athlete. So he just can't get the same push off that they can. So he has to compensate for that with his upper legs, and a lot of that's with his core strength, you know, using the muscles of his stomach and back and his hips in order to generate that speed that he's, and generate the power that he's losing from his casts and his ankles. To be honest, almost all the athletes that compete in the Paralympics have the dream of competing in the Olympics someday. Oscar's dream was obviously one of the more realistic ones, but even if you watch the opening ceremonies, there were a couple of other athletes that'll be competing in the Paralympics, competing in the Olympics as well. I believe one in archery and one in table tennis. When anybody with a disability sort of breaks a barrier, like Oscar making it into the Olympics and running and being on international television and showing what people, the abilities of people with disabilities, you know, that helps elevate everybody. It sets goals for kids and young people, for some of our wounded soldiers and Marines coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan with amputations or other disabilities to aspire to achieve higher levels. And it's one of those, you know, sort of that cliche, you know, even if you shoot for the moon, you fall short, you're still among the stars. And it's that same sort of concept. If Oscar raises the bar as other people, then it sets a higher bar or higher goals for other people with disabilities. But all of that, it changes the attitudes of society. You could just see how the other runners were, like when James, you know, wanted to trade numbers with Oscar Pistorius at the end of the semifinal, where the other athletes, you know, congratulated him, gave him a hug. They treat him as an athlete, and they were, you know, like in the interview when he said in the 2 hours when they were sort of in the holding area waiting to go out on the track, he was viewed as another athlete. You know, they were focusing on their race. They were all gentlemen and ladies afterwards treating him. And that is, you know, that's a role model for everybody. Say that, you know, that's what most people with disabilities want. They want to be treated like another person. They want to be treated with respect. If they're an athlete or a scientist or a physician or going to school or, you know, like some of our soldiers or Marines who continue on active duty, they just want to be part of that group. We have been testing prosthetic feet for soldiers and Marines that want to continue on active duty and redeploy to combat. It's sort of the same kind of goal. You can think of them as tactical athletes, Oscar Pistorius being an Olympic-style athlete. So we're designing that special technology for them. We're working on a hand cycle for the next Paralympics out of carbon fiber, robotic wheelchairs for people that don't have the use of their arms and legs in order to be able to function fully in society, go shopping on their own, prepare meals on their own, work, go to school. So it's perfectly in line with what we do. We're constantly working on new technologies, evaluating those technologies, and creating a clinical training in science in order to deploy those technologies so that people with disabilities can be fully integrated into school, work, sports, politics, religion, family. What's really helped Oscar a lot is his parents, he has a brother, and his parents, they treated Oscar just like his brother. They afforded him the same opportunities to play sports and expect him to do well in school. And they, by setting those expectations, you know, Oscar didn't feel limited. And he felt that he had the freedom to explore goals that people, when he was a child, thought were totally unrealistic, and he made them come true. This year I won the American Association for the Advancement of Science's Mentor Award for my work in mentoring people with disabilities to become scientists, engineers, physicians. And while I was there, I was going through the exhibit hall, and NBC had a booth about the science behind hockey within the National Science Foundation area. And I've had a lot of National Science Foundation grants, including the National, I'm the co-director of the National Science Foundation Engineering Research Center on Quality of Life Technology, exactly what Oscar's using, Quality of Life Technology, and several training grants from the National Science Foundation, as well as the VA Rehabilitation Research and Development Center. I approached them, I said, you should do something on the Paralympics. And they said, well, we have a number of stories planned for the Olympics. I said, well, you know, there's some great athletes in the Paralympics. There's a lot of technology involved in the Paralympics, a lot of science involved in the Paralympics, just like there are in the Olympics. And I think people would appreciate that. And so they gave me their card. We exchanged emails. I contacted my program officer at NSF, was helping to sponsor those programs with NBC. And a few months later, they called me up and said that they talked and they decided they wanted to do a story about the Paralympics, but then they also thought I was sort of one of the few engineers in NSF, you know, that been involved in sports. I competed in the Paralympics myself in 1988 and had qualified for the Olympic trials in 1980 as a runner. And so they thought, well, he's a scientist, he's an engineer, he knows the Olympics, knows the Paralympics. And so we talked, did a segment on the Paralympics, and then we did a couple segments related to just the Olympics in general. So money is always a major factor. So you know, one of the Oscars had the good fortune that he has access to the current state of the art in prosthetic technology and excellent prosthetists to do the fitting of that technology. And he has access to technology to train it as he, to change it as he gets faster, as the track surfaces change, just like runners might change their shoes, change their stride, change their step count a little bit. Oscar has the ability to change his prosthetic feet and his sockets for those conditions. Most people don't have that, those resources available to them. What I hope is that outside of the VA and the military in the United States, people have to buy their own technology for prosthetics, for sports or for activities besides just getting around the house or walking. And but it shows you that if you do have access to the right technology, you could achieve your Olympic dreams, but even just below that, it's important to stay fit, stay healthy, avoid secondary complications, and having access to good technology is important for all people with disabilities because it allows them to more fully participate in society, and being healthy is a big part of that. If there's somebody in the Pittsburgh region that wants to go to the Paralympics or be the next person with a disability competing in the Olympics, then I suggest that they go to the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, Center for Assistive Technology, or UPMC Mercy Rehab Institute. And there are clinicians there that can help connect them with the technology, connect them with the trainers. And of course, John Sikora and the HOPE Network here is a Paralympic sports program. Has access to a lot of the tools and the coaches to help people build those skills as well. We have world-class healthcare and world-class rehab, world-class research, and world-class clinicians. And we're sort of the ideal place for the next Oscar Pistorius is to come out of the Pittsburgh region. We have all the pieces of the puzzle here.